Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ruben González. I work for Telefónica Digital, the product development and innovation, and I'm the head of development and architecture. Today, I'd like to talk about the element that powers the digital world, software. I think it's very important to understand what software is and what software development is in order to get to the digital world, especially if you are interested in competing in the digital world, because software is at the heart, at the core of the digital world, and at the core of our digital lives. The idea of my presentation is to give you an opinion and a personal view of what software development is and how we should treat software development. First, I would like to raise awareness about what is usually missed when it comes to software development. Second, I will give you my favorite understanding and definition of what software development is. And third, I would like to give you some pieces of advice to deal effectively with software. All of these are probably the basics of the Agile and all of these methods, paradigms, etc. And I think it's quite important to understand first what is the element we are dealing with, software. First of all, raising awareness. Let's start with a little bit of history. A history about how we have been dealing with software during the past 60 years. In the early days of computing, programming was a pure craft. It was done by programmers that were wiring cables directly into the computer. Machines were simple, or at least were not as complex as they are today. And programming was a sort of craft in which we could predict upfront what we were doing with the computer, because our brain, our mind, was more powerful than the computer. By the late 60s, people started to be concerned about software development, because the computer power increased a lot, and dealing with the machine became a really complex task, because of the number of instructions per second they were able to execute, the computing capacity, the memory, and all of the hardware that increases a lot in power. Then, people at that time thought that they were in crisis in terms of software development, because many projects started to fail, delivered late, over budget, sort of specifications, and they thought they were in crisis. They needed something to come up to solve the crisis. They thought that by adding some sort of engineering methods, disciplines to the software development, perhaps they could improve the productivity, quality, and predictability of software development. By the late 80s, in the mid-80s, all of these silver bullets they thought that they were able to solve the software crisis were not achieving the results in terms of productivity or quality they thought. They improved a lot the way we were, the way we developed software at that time by adding new methods, tools, formal methods that helped at that time improve the software quality software. But still, projects continue failing, being delayed, not meeting the expectation of the customers. There is this famous paper from Fred Brooks that said that there are no silver bullet when it comes to software development. Then the industry started to think in new ways of dealing with software that were more adaptive, more iterative. The Agile principles and Agile methodologies are based on these iterative, incremental methods that were developed during the 90s, and they have become probably the best way to deal with software. What is interesting for me is that no matter all of these improvements in the way we develop software, still there is this cliché about software development teams that deliver late, over budget, and sort of specifications. There is this famous cartoon that you probably already know that reflects very well this cliché. This is what the customer explained the system he wanted. This is how the project leader understood it, how the analyst designed it, how the programmer implemented the system, how the project was documented, how it was installed. how the customer was built and what the customer really needed. It seems that nobody is understanding what is the need, what is the problem, and what is the solution for that problem. And this is quite usual in software projects. There is this standing group consulting that makes the CALF report, and sustainably, during the past 40 years, or 30 years, I don't remember exactly how many years have been doing this report, 44% of the software projects don't deliver on time, or they are per budget, or short of specifications. About 26% failed, directly failed, and only 32% deliver on time. Why is this happening? Are we not understanding software? In fact, in software development, we have probably the most brainy people in the world doing software, dealing with the complexity of the machine. But we are not understanding pretty well what software development is and what software is. And probably all of these metrics are wrong. We are measuring the wrong thing when it comes to software development. In order to help you understand what is software development, I would like to introduce you a close friend of mine, which is Dennis. Dennis is a software developer. Dennis loves coding, loves programming. He programs at work, at home, during nights, during weekends. He's always learning new technologies. He's a computer nerd, a geek that loves computing. Observing Dennis when he's coding, I can see the following. He has something in mind, which is an idea or algorithm he wants to solve, a problem he wants to solve with the computer. He starts coding. Once he starts coding and has something, he runs this code into the machine. He tests the outcome to see if it meets the idea he had in mind, and it starts in a continuous cycle of synthesis, analysis of what he had developed, and getting feedback to start thinking again in the problem and in the solution. I have another close friend, which is an artist, is Leonard. Leonard is a famous painter. He loves painting. He is always talking about painting, doing new different things with paintings. He's like the computer nerd, but with painting. Observing Leonard when he's painting, it comes out that he has something in mind, which is it could be an idea, an abstract idea, a physical thing he wants to paint. He starts painting, and once he gets something painted, he starts changing continuously what he had painted and the idea he had in mind, till he gets something that works for him. Seems that there are not so much difference between Leonard and Dennis. And I would like to raise this because probably sometimes we don't understand properly what software development is in terms of what it means in dealing and obtaining a solution that runs into the computer. Going a little bit further with this comparison, the artist's continuous flow is something like that. It starts with an intention. This intention is synthesized in a realization. From the realization, he or she gets feedback, adjusts the intention, and then generates a new realization. He needs to generate the realization in order to figure out and find out what is the intention. And he's always continuously in this flow of synthesis, feedback, synthesis, and feedback. Going a little bit deeper with the developer, we find exactly the same. He has an intention in his mind. He needs to synthesize that intention into a realization, which is software. He needs to run and test this realization in order to get feedback, and then starts adjusting both the intention and the realization in a continuous flow till he gets something that works into the computer. If we look at the attributes of a good artist, we find that a good artist must have knowledge about the different techniques for painting. He must have mastery in applying that techniques. He must have talent, motivation, inspiration. He should be a passionate about painting, and overall, he should be a genius. The good developers I know have exactly the same attributes. He must have knowledge about the technology, knowledge about the different techniques of programming, knowledge about how to deal with a computer. He must have mastery in using that knowledge. He must have also motivation. He must also have creativity. They are solving problems that needs to come up with solution to a complex problem. He needs inspiration, he needs passion, and the really good ones are genius. If we compare art with pure engineering, art is unpredictable, while engineering works on predictable things. In engineering, we have processes. In art, we have practices. Knowledge in art is tacit. In engineering, is split, although we can have explicit knowledge when it comes to art. Art is done by humans. Engineering can be streamlined to industrial processes. If you look at software development versus pure engineering, software engineering is overall unpredictable. It's uncertain. There are not mathematical models that can allow us to predict what the software system would be from a specification. In other engineering disciplines, we have mathematical models coming from science that allow engineers to predict the outcome without building it. In software development, we need to build the system in order to know if we are building the right system. And this is why we need to test. We need, because we don't have models allowing us to predict the outcome. Most of the knowledge of good programmers is tacit too. There are good practices. Processes exist also in engineering development, but at the end, there is no systematic way to transform a problem into a software solution. We need humans to do that. In engineering, we can have processes that can be automated by machines and then produce the outcome. This leads me to the question, if software is crafting or engineering. You have to say something, probably I would say, I am saying that software is closer to crafting and artwork than engineering. Although there are good engineering disciplines and practices that can be applied to improve the way we developed software. Going a little bit deeper with this, is it a craft or an art? Well, the difference between craft and art is just the amount of talent and genius. You could be a home painter, or you could be the best landscape painter in the world. You could use the same techniques you are using the paintings, but at the end it's just a matter of talent and genius. And what is the beauty in software development? What is this beauty we can see in nice paintings? This beauty is purely mental in software development. In software, you can see that beauty in the way the code is written, in the way the code run into the machine, how the different parts of the system interact when they are running into the machine. This could have mental beauty. It could be elegant solutions. It could have attributes as the same as the paintings have. But it's something that it cannot be perceived by our human senses. You need to use your brain to see the beauty of the software, about how it's being built and how it runs into the computer. So, probably, this is something that not everybody is understanding about software. We have been trying to have plans to deliver software. We have been trying to have processes to build software. At the end, it's a pure human creative activity. And since that is purely unpredictable, we need to adapt continuously the process or the development to what is happening in the pure development of the system. This leads me to my second part, which is what is software and what is software development. And I would like to give you my favorite definition of what is software development. Software development is a process of knowledge transformation that is creative and human. Knowledge transformation about what? About a problem and a solution. We need to understand the problem and the solution at the same time. And in order to understand the problem, we need to get the solution. And this is the really complicated thing. Doing both things, both understandings in parallel. This process happens through a continuous synthesis. We need to pass from the the problem to the solution. We need to create the software to understand what is the problem and what is the solution. And this is the common failure in most of the projects of software development. People think, or tend to think, that they can know the problem up front, but they don't know what is the problem till they don't get a first solution or several solutions of the problem. And this is why in the cartoon, the customer didn't know exactly what he needed. Till he doesn't have the software system, he cannot get what is the problem he needs to solve. This knowledge is acquired through time. Through this process of continuous synthesis, you get knowledge about both things, the problem and the solution. This continuous synthesis is at the same time iterative and incremental. We tend to think that it's always iterative, but not. It combines both things. Iterations are for finding out what is the solution and the problem. Iterations that are for improving what we have, but also we combine incremental development, which is for adding new functionality to the system, or when we know what we are dealing with, what are the parts of the system, to add new parts to the system. I like to say that these cycles of continuous synthesis are iterative mental, are iterative plus incremental. Since it's a process that is creative, that is iterative mental, software emerges and grows through this process of continuous synthesis. It's exactly the same process that a book writer follows when he starts writing a book story. We start with a blank page, we start with an intention, with an idea of what of the story we want to write down. And then we start writing, adding paragraphs, adding the story in small pieces, refactoring part of the story till we get what we want. At the end, the book emerges. In software, happens exactly the same. The system emerges, and emerges in all of this its dimensions. Emerge as the software system running into the computer. Emerge the specification of the system, the functionality that the system has, and emerge the architecture. Emerge both the problem and the solution. It's something that you get through this process of continuous synthesis. Emergence is a key characteristic of complex systems. And software is probably one of the most complex things we are dealing with in the current world. What is also interesting for me is that this knowledge transformation requires understanding what and how in multiple dimensions. At the dimension of the domain of the system, the dimension, the domain of, at the user level, we need to know what are the problem for the user. We need to know what is the solution for the user. Internally to the system, we need to know both the problem, what and how, for the different parts of the system. And this continues to the maximum level of detail, which is coding. Since requires multiple levels of knowledge, software development usually requires also multiple disciplines working together. It's not just about software developers. We need also to understand humans interacting with the computer. We need human factors. We need user experience designers. We need people that knows the domain of the system. We need to know all of these dimensions when it comes to software. Also, this continuous synthesis process of passing from intention to realization continuously happens on multiple levels. It happens at team level. Sometimes this is called in the agile methods the iteration. But it also happens continuously at individual level. Developers are continuously iterating for iterative development or incremental development in the day-to-day work. And it happens all of them combined together. But the ones, since that work at the maximum level of detail in this continuous synthesis of software, are the developers. This is the ones that really deal with the complexity of the machine. Since machines today are more powerful than they were 40 years ago, that complexity could be really, really high. Other disciplines work at less level of detail, but the impact of the changes on the user space can impact really, really heavily in the technical solution. All of them are important, but the most complex part are the ones that the developers are doing. And this is why in software development, software developers are essential. They do the most complex part of the process of knowledge transformation, which is transforming knowledge into source code, into code that can run into the machine to solve the problem and the solution. To conclude this part, I would say that software is a form of knowledge. It's where the knowledge we have about the problem and the solution is realized as a physical asset. It's been realized as a software. So now we have seen that, just to summarize, that software is a process of knowledge transformation that is creative and human, that is based on continuous synthesis that is at the same time iterative and incremental. And it has multiple levels of detail. The ones that work at the maximum level of detail are the developers. Since then, developers are essential in software development. Now that we know a little bit more about what is software development, I would like to move on to the next section, which is a set of pieces of advice to effectively deal with software. The first one is work in short and small steps. Since we don't know up front what will be the solution, we need to discover what is the solution. So a good practice is work in small steps. Small steps are multiple levels of detail. At team level, work with small cycles of 2, 3, maximum 4 weeks. If you can work with 1 week, better than with 2 weeks. You need to create the software, the working software, to see what is the problem and what is the solution. Working in this way is a natural thing to embrace the change, because change is part of the discovery process. The only measure of progress in this type of working is software that works, software that runs into the machine. That's what it means, working software. Software that is able to run into the computer. And you need to run the software into the computer to test the software and see what is the problem and what is the solution you are trying to discover through the process. All of these cycles happens at team level and individual level. Individual level is what the developer, what the user experience designer do. They are continuously passing from the intention to the realization into the machine, just to get more knowledge about the problem and the solution they are trying to face. Iterations, or sort of cycles of synthesis, should be value-driven. Value-driven means that you are committed to get the maximum value possible from the resources you have. This is essentially what is value-driven. Compared to the traditional approach, which is plan-driven, in plan-driven, you specify first what you want to do. You specify targets, and then you estimate resource and time to do that. In the value-driven approach, you have a fixed time and resources, and your commitment is to extract the maximum value from the resources. Rather than planning what you are going to do, you try to obtain the maximum value possible. It's the comparison I like to make is comparing chess with poker. In chess, you are continuously planning what is the next thing you want to do with your pieces. In poker, you are betting, and you are betting to obtain the maximum value possible. You have the intention to get the maximum value possible. And then you synthesize, you make your play, and you try to obtain the maximum value possible. And this is what it's about, is value driven. This is also something that businesses don't understand very well. They tend to think that they need to plan at the beginning, plan up front. This way of working, when you are dealing with uncertainty, is much better, because you don't put at the stake of the project resources at the beginning. You have a limit of money you want to spend, and you start monitoring continuously what is the value delivered. And from that value delivered, you decide go, cancel, or adjust the project. And you have always the door to leave the project if it's not delivering the value that you are expecting. But you need to discover what is the value you are trying to get. Another good practice is make the system grow and emerge through this process of continuous synthesis and adaptation from an idea to a solution, a system that works and generates value for the customer. Since all of this process is purely iterative, incremental, and certain, that means that they cannot be planned, you should avoid what I call buffs, big upfront designs, plans, estimations. You should have intentional planning, intentional design, but you should be aware that this plan can change during the process of software development. It's purely intentional because you need to discover what is your problem and your solution. Well, it's not always as extreme as I'm explaining here. You could have some upfront planning when it's a system that you have been built several times. You could know upfront what is the design, what are the specifications. You have been building the same system for different companies or for different types of products. But your estimations will only work if you are using the same team for building the system. You change the team, you change the knowledge, you change the motivation, you change the creativity of the people that is in charge of building the system. And all of those, your estimations could radically change. So you need to work continuously, adaptively, to see what is going on, learn by doing, and from that knowledge, extract what is the problem, what is the solution, and decide on the goal. Since the problem needs to be also discovered by the customer, it's a really good idea, I would say, it's a must to have customers in the team. They need to get what is their problem and the solution they want. It's the same as a painter does with someone that wants a portrait. He's actively part of the process of the painting. But you should do the same with software. You should have customers, users in your team. Since software development requires multiple levels of knowledge and multiple domains, another good practice is to blend multiple disciplines around a team. I'm saying blend. Blend their knowledge into the system, not working in silos. They should share the knowledge in order to get to know what is the problem and the solution. And the problem has multiple dimensions and the solution also have multiple dimensions. You cannot have people sit in a silo specifying the user interface without knowing if this user interface is feasible to realize into the computer or not. Both teams should work in that case together in order to get what is the best user interface for the system that is feasible to implement into the computer. In this sort of teams, you should foster open communications and collaborations. At the end, it's all about to have the team working together, sharing the knowledge and working with the same goal of generating a system that needs to know the problem, the solution in multiple dimensions and that requires multiple disciplines. Since software needs to solve problems that are really complex and to solve complex problems you need creative ideas, it's a good idea to have a creative environment. A creative environment that fosters creativity and also attracts creativity. Developers and the people involved in software development should feel the freedom to play. Freedom to play and discover what is the problem and the solution. You should play with knowledge. Knowledge in the multiple dimensions of the system and in the software, specifically in the software dimension. It's not only about having a creative environment and creative people. You should also inspire the creativity. You cannot buy creativity, but you can inspire it. And you should allow an environment in which people can have open connections between them, with the outside world, with different pieces of knowledge, and also they should have pauses to have allowing emerge creativity and eureka moments. We are facing complexity. We are facing complex problems, and we need to allow people to come up with a eureka idea to solve the problems in all the dimensions of the product and the system. If you continuously pressure the team, probably you are not going to get the best solution. You need to have a relaxed environment in which people come up with solutions that are creative. but creative people don't like at all are goals and constraints. You should feel challenged. And you're a manager, or you should inspire them, you should facilitate them, and give directions, not set goals. Setting goals is limiting the creativity. People should feel that they are free to come up with the maximum possible. And they should feel committed to deliver the maximum value possible. They should have a challenge. A challenge that inspires them all mornings when they wake up. They should have something in his mind, remembering them that they should come up with something that is really valuable for the customers, really valuable as a technology, something that makes the difference. It's like the challenges that some companies in the digital world have, like Google, indexing of the world information. It's something that puts you a challenge. So this is something quite important when it comes to software development. Teams should have challenges. They should feel inspired. Another good practice, since we are dealing with complexity, is simplify at maximum that complexity. And complexity has two dimensions. One is essential complexity. Essential is the complexity that is inherent to the problem we need to solve. It's something that comes with the problem. Accidental complexity grows from the things we add to solve that essential complexity. Is usually in the form of library, frameworks, databases, all of these things that developers love to put in their system to solve the problem. Developers are usually problem solvers. They like to solve complex things. And if they don't have something that is complex, they create it. So we should be aware about that accidental complexity that can put at stake many projects. And we should try to minimize the essential complexity that comes with the problem. Because dealing with the computer is complex. So if we add more complexity to that, we are putting at stake any work we do with the computer. Another good practice. Adapt methods, practices, methodologies to the team, not the opposite. There are a bunch of agile methods that people sometimes follow as a religion. They start with the workflow and they try to put that into the team as something that is mandatory. Remember that we are dealing with creative work and we are dealing with creative people. So we should add anything we add to that team is just to help and facilitate the team, not to create constraints or restrictions. And we should be very careful of the practices we impose to the team. We should feel that they really help and facilitate them in doing their job, dealing with the complexity and generating creative solutions. We shouldn't force any methodology, any process. This restricts creativity. It's like setting goals. Most companies I know, especially management and business people, don't know that the software is an asset, and they don't treat it as an asset. You think it's something that the developers write in their computers and nobody cares about that. We should treat software as an asset. Why? Because it's where our knowledge about the problem and the solution is realized. And in all the projects we do with software development, we should treat the software as the essential asset we need to take care of. Not only backing up the software, but also caring about the quality of the code that is being written, about how the software is being managed, structured, etc. We should take care of software because it's the asset we generate in the process of knowledge transformation. And from that asset is where the system is generated, the system that we deploy and put in the hands of our customers. At the end, when it comes to software development, what really matters is having talented people, because we are dealing with something that is human, is creative, and to solve complex problems, we need really talented people that is able to work as a team player, that is passionate, that feels motivated, inspired to generate the best solution possible. And this is what it really matters when it comes to software development. Not processes, not tools, not any other things. They are important, but what is really important is having talented people. As a conclusion to my talk, I would like to summarize everything I have been talking about as being aware of software, being soft aware. This is the best recommendation I think I could give you to deal with software. Being aware of what you are doing. What you are doing is dealing with complexity, understanding problems and understanding solutions at the same time. Creating something that should run into the machine, which is really, really complex thing to do. And if we are aware of what we are doing, I think we can manage better what we do with software, how we plan projects, how we deal with software at the end. And this is, for me, the essential key point, all of this Agile Manifesto and Craftsmanship Manifesto. All of that is about dealing with software from the point of view of something that knows what software development and software is. And that's all from my side. If you have any questions, I will try to do my best in answering them.